Good morning to all of you. It's World Environment Day. And I must thank the Wildlife Institute of India for having me here, and especially Bitapi, who conceptualized this talk, because what she wanted me to talk about was how do you plan and get into the implementation of eco-restoration. And I must tell you that it's a very slow process. It doesn't happen very rapidly, and it doesn't always happen the way you want it to happen. So that's what eco-restoration is about. May I have the next slide, please? So if you look at these four slides, the upper slide on the left side is a forest eco-restoration program, which has been around for the last 30 years. And I'll talk a little bit about this at the end of the program today. The slide on your upper right is actually a picture from Bharatpur. Now, the Bharatpur Maharajas took this area, they released water into it and made these shallow pans to attract birds as part of their hunting and shikar things that they did. The lower one on the left side is a mangrove restoration done by a corporate, by Godrej's in Thane and Bombay. And there are grassland pictures which they did in Gujarat and Saurashtra, also by the Maharajas, where they actually had cheetah hunting and where they had falconing and so on and so forth. So for us, eco-restoration in a vague sense is not new. So what is really, what constitutes eco-restoration, which we do for biodiversity? Next slide, please. So I think we need to understand that eco-restoration really is to bring nature back. It's about naturalness. And it's about doing that in terms of ecosystems, species, even genetics. So this is something which actually is a very important part. And it is this biological part of it is embedded in the abiotic part of that site which you are going to look at. So it's more important, I think, to look at what is not eco-restoration. And it's not a simple plantation, as you see in that lower picture, which is a teak plantation. It's certainly not just soil and water management of a small hydro catchment area. It's not an arboretum or botanical specimens planted all over the place. So there are many ways in which you can define eco-restoration. But there are two, next please. But if we start looking at the implementation angle of this, then there are several aspects that you look at off-site and several aspects that you look at on-site. So if you look at the off-site and say, what should I plant here? Many people ask this question always, that if you say eco-restoration, what should I plant? And I said the best way to look at it is go to your closest protected area and see, do a species abundance curve there of the trees that are there, of shrubs and climbers and ground flora, and try to bring all those back. And that is really what eco-restoration is about. But to do that, off-site, you have to collect seeds and you have to develop an indigenous tree nursery. And that then brings you to a sapling stage, which you can transport back into your site. So that is the off-site part of it. On-site, you need a study right in the beginning. You need a study to understand what is the topography, characteristics of the soil, and so on. Because if you plant the wrong things on the wrong sort of soil, you are not going to get an eco-restoration at all. So selection of the site and protection of that site is very important, because if you don't protect it or degraded it in the first place, it will swing back to the degraded state after you're finished, which is very frustrating. So this is what you want there. And you certainly want, in a forest eco-restoration thing, you want trees, shrubs, climbers, and so on. In a wetland, you want the different levels in a wetland. In a grassland area, you need what are the species of grasses that are normally going to grow there well. So these are the types of things that you need in terms of the tools and methodologies that you use even before you start. Next, please. Now, therefore, one of the major objectives that you want to do is to reverse the trends that have occurred, that have brought about degradation. And to do that, there are two ways. One way is to leave nature alone to bounce back on its own, but that takes a very long time. And the other is to try and augment that and make it speed up that process. But basically, it is nature coming back to its own original form. So here you see two different things. One is the Bharatpur thing that I mentioned to you earlier, which was actually an engineered ecosystem, right? Which manages their water levels, manages the flow, inflow, outflow, and so on. And the other one is more or less a spontaneous regrowth in a little village called Jaluki in Nagaland, where they have done a fantastic eco-restoration job over 20 years. And this is something where nature has come back on its own without them doing too much. So next, please. So if you look at how people have gone about defining eco-restoration, then there are various terms and many authors refer to them interchangeably. So don't worry too much about this. But one is this whole process of what they refer to as reclamation of an area, where you are looking at both productive or consumptive uses. The other is restoration itself, which involves bringing ecological integrity back. The third is what is referred to as reinstatement by some people, which is trying to get the pre-degraded ecosystem back in terms of its structure and function, and rehabilitation, which means that it is something that you are trying to move towards that reinstatement process. Replacement is another term which has been used, which is sort of creating an alternate ecosystem. So like the Bharatpur area, which was just a grassland and grazing land, which the Maharajas created into a wetland, I would put that as a replacement. It wasn't a wetland in the first place, right? So let's go to the next slide. There are also social questions that you need to ask. How are you going to look at this? You are going to do something which is there for ecology, but you're also going to look at, in many places, or probably all of them, how are you going to involve local people in that eco-development, eco-restoration process, which we often refer to as eco-development, right? So this is another part of it. And here, I recall once talking to my friend W.A. Rogers, Alan Rogers, about this. And he said, you know, Doc, you're not going to bring species back. What you have to do is manage people. And I remember this, that it is so very important that we have to look at what is people's desire in this kind of a process. And if we don't do that, that eco-restoration will not survive. The other part of it is, how do you monitor this? And I have always, I'm an avid bird watcher. So I believe that if you look at the birds coming back, it's restoration. But there are many other things to look at. You look at amphibia, for instance. Did your amphibia come back in a wetland? Did your fish come back? And did the fish that you wanted to come back from a restoration angle come back? So these are things which you look at throughout the process of eco-restoration, and eco-development therefore becomes a part of eco-restoration as well. Next, please. The next thing that you need to look at is, you need an indigenous plant nursery, especially from the surrounding area there where some protection has already been done. So apart from controlling the site, you also need to look at something outside the site which you will use back. For example, in the nursery that I'm going to talk to you about a little later, it is from the Western Ghats, which we have grown in our own Environment Institute. But you can also have to do that for mangroves. And I've looked at many of these habitat improvement processes for mangroves. And then I want to tell you that it's not always that you want a mangrove back. You may want a mud bank back. You know, so you have to be very careful about what is your final objective. Next, please. How do you monitor and evaluate these steps that you do in implementation? So one is, it's always nice to not just look at what you have planted and which has grown back, but what has spontaneously come back? And I think that is something very important. Of course, you have to be very careful because what spontaneously returns is sometimes invasive exotics, and that has to be removed periodically. So you need to look at the reappearance of indicator species. It may be mammals, birds, reptiles, amphibia, insect life. And there I want to bring about what is really different when you want a really well done eco-restoration thing in either an aquatic or a terrestrial system. Does that aquatic ecosystem have all the microhabitats that you would like to have there, right? Does that terrestrial ecosystem have an adequate canopy cover, a shrub layer, climbers, and ground flora? That is the end product. So the tunnel for that is a very long tunnel, and it's not a straight tunnel. So you never see the light at the end of the tunnel at the beginning. That tunnel seems to meander through that mountain, and suddenly you emerge there after several years sometimes to see what you actually had a vision for in the beginning. And that vision, therefore, is incredibly important. The most important thing that you need to look at is to get rid of invasives. And very often, this has not been done. Next, please. So if you look at my next slide, it talks, this is a simulated sort of thing. It's a deforestation where fragmentation and change in land use has occurred. So you have a natural landscape, then you have a sort of semi-cultural landscape with degraded forest. Then you have a further degraded forest, which is shifting more or less into illegal cultivation. And then you have a cultural landscape, which has become agriculture. Next, please. So this is the process by which that kind of degradation or fragmentation happens. Now, our attempt in an eco-restoration is to transfer this in a reverse process. And so you can see the same slide put in reverse, where you find how, from step by step through four stages, you have taken an illegally encroached area back into a full 80% canopy cover. Now, this may take many, many years, depending on what sort of forest you're trying to do this in. So these are very important, that there are these steps of eco-restoration. Next, please. Where you look at on-site things again and off-site things. And if your selection of species has been appropriate offline, you will start seeing the benefits of eco-restoration. Next, please. You may have to then look at a next phase, where you may want to remove the grazing, which is already there, or you may want to, in a riverine system, stop the sand mining that is there. So these are equally important things when you try to restore a river or when you try to restore a grassland system. Wherever you're looking at this, this whole thing of just trying to put something back there apparently does not work. And the removal of whatever impacts were there is probably the most important thing to do, because if you don't do this, in our experience, which I'll show you later, this has been really bad. It's been disastrous also. Now, the other thing that one should look at is detailing, introducing microhabitat in your restoration program. Next, please. Which will show you that you need to monitor this very, very carefully. And monitoring the return of fauna, I think, is the best thing. And of course, I always believe that birds are the best thing to look at, because they seem to come back earlier than other things. Now, if your plants are going to come back from outside, which you have not planted there themselves, that's a very good indicator that your birds are bringing your seeds back, and so on and so forth. So there are many linkages in this. Next, please, where this whole process happens. And what you have to be very careful is that it does not start reverting back to its degraded state. So there are a whole lot of ways of doing that, but the main thing is the protection that you give it after your eco-restoration has been done. Now, in your site planning, you have to look at several things. And I want to use this picture as an indicator of what you need to do. You know, eco-restoration, in fact, ecology itself, is a cascade of things that are happening all the time like this, right? And those cascading steps are there, but between each cascading step, there is an ecological process. that happens 24/7. And this is what you need to monitor. Is that happening in your eco-restored area? And here, for example, you want your vegetation, which is near that stream, to come back the way it was. You want the little pooling that happens. You want the rapids that happens. These are the micro level aspects that you need to look at. Do you have a sufficient amount of nectar yielding or fruiting trees so that your birds and squirrels and whatever with these small mammals would come back, right? And what is happening in your aquatic ecosystem? So apart from the planning process, the monitoring has to continue to do all this process. Next, please. So the most frequent question they ask, people ask is, what is the natural cover that you want? How far back do you want to go? This is something that you have to think of very carefully. In fact, it may not have been a forest system. It may have been a grassland system. How far back do you want to go? And that you have to decide upfront and say, what is the structure, the composition, and the functional aspects, the nutrient cycling and so on, that you want to happen in a system? What are the birds that you want to get back? What are the animals, that mammals that can come back? You don't want elephants, tigers walking on roadsides, as we see in so many. I get all these constantly from somewhere or other. And that's not what we're looking for. We're looking for small mammals to come back. We are looking for partridges and quails, not necessarily the great Indian bustard, but that would be wonderful if it comes back. So how do you bring these micro habitats about in the different systems? Even in a forest, you want some boggy areas, you want marshes, you want rocky outcrops for large mammals, to carnivores, to find a home. You want old trees so that you get your owls back and your various civets and things which love large trees. So these are the things that you have to look at. Next, please. So micro habitats is something that you need to look at in this eco-restoration process. And how do you monitor this? There are two things about monitoring. You need to look at all the, next please. You need to look at all these follow-up activities that you want to do, which prevent the reversal of doing this. And I really feel that once we have an ecologically restored area, then public awareness for that becomes perhaps the most important thing to do, that you can reverse these processes, and that you can have your forests back, you can have your wetlands back. Next, please. But please, very quickly, to try, go through these three, four slides. This is a semi-arid, was a semi-arid grassland area, which was very badly degraded. And a certain amount of restoration was done here, but you want to keep it as a grassland. You don't want to plant exotic trees like you see at the back, right? So this is something that is grassland represented. Next, please. You could even want to have your scrubland and thorn forests back like this. So it's not necessary that you go and plant deciduous trees in this kind of an area. And finally, you have to look at what is the forest type that you want there. And that comes from Champion and Sate and looking at the most abundant ones, but also looking at the trees that may have been uncommon there. So that gives you an idea of what the composition should be like. And once you have the composition right, the functions take place on their own. Next, please. And finally, things do recolonize. And when you recolonize these things with what comes back, that's very exciting, because you suddenly find that in an area, something that you haven't seen for many, many years has actually come back. Next, please. So here you have something where recolonization of several species tell you that your eco-restoration has actually worked. Now, there are some of these things here where you need to look very carefully at coastal areas and marine habitats. And perhaps the most important thing now for us to do is to rehabilitate a whole lot of systems there. You need to look at mangroves. We definitely need to look at mud banks. We need to look at the splash zone of the sea where you have got a rocky coastline. You need to look at seagrass. And of course, most importantly, we need to look at coral reefs. So all this part of the marine habitat and the coastal habitats need very close attention now for rehabilitating and for restoration. Next, please. There are some things which now will come out more and more strongly. We will need to understand, both in natural as well as in cultural ecosystems, that climate change, we have to learn to adapt to climate change, right? And this is referred to nowadays as ecosystem-based adaptation to climate change. And we need to understand for that, and that's very complex very often, what is likely to happen with climate change with 2 degrees centigrade rise of temperature. We know, for example, coastal areas definitely will get inundated with saline water. That's easier to handle, right? So these are the kinds of things, but there are many hidden cryptic things in this which we don't know enough about. And there, we have to use the what is known as the precautionary principle, that you take precautions even though I may not have good scientific evidence today of what is likely to happen, by a good gut feel, you know. It's not that you have hard science every time, though that is what is most desirable. But if you don't have it, it doesn't mean you neglect it. And I think this is very critically important. You need to be able to have good judgments as a good ecologist to do this. Now I'm going to next, Anjali. Now I'm going to tell you a few quick stories, right? The first story is about what I first got involved with. There was a very, very dynamic MD of telco in the old days. And he was supposed to manufacture trucks. And he was a bit of a shikari, but he was also very interested in wildlife and conservation. And he told his people that, he told the Tatas that, I want to build a dam there. And they said, you're supposed to make trucks here. What are you talking about making a dam? He said, no, one day this semi-arid area outside Pune is going to need water. And if you don't have water, your factory will close down. And they allowed him, the shareholders allowed him to do this crazy idea. And we used to sit, and he had a lot of tame birds and things. He had a pair of Saras cranes also. And we were sitting photographing his Saras cranes. And he said, you know, there's so many ducks here and none of them seem to nest here. And I said, so most of your ducks are migrants, they won't nest here. But also you've got a deep lake. You don't have a marsh for your marsh birds. So he sent for his car, which was in those days a Mercedes. So for me, it was wonderful sitting in a new Mercedes. And he said, let's take a round and you tell me where to build this marsh. And within the next 3 weeks, he had taken his bulldozers and made a fantastic place where in the next rainfall, it was already beginning to fill up. And you could do this if you wanted to do this. So this corporate boss was able to do that. And today, it is probably one of the best nesting colonies of storks and ibis and whatever in an urban area, in an industrial establishment. Now, he also had this very unique thing, which you see in the slide there, which he called a drum nursery, where he used to grow plants to a height of 6 feet and transfer this back to villagers as fruit trees. So he had an incredible ability to look forward into ecological things. And we did many, many wonderful things together. Next, please. The next is our own experience, where I took those trees from him as large 6-8 feet trees and planted them around 1997-98 behind my Environment Institute. And the other slide you see there is at 2000-2003. And now you can see the full canopy that has come up there. Unfortunately, we lost 50% of our nature trail in road widening. And you all sitting in Wildlife Institute have this wonderful, wonderful place just behind your hostels there, where I every time come there, I walk there in late evening, sometimes at night. It's such a delightful place to be in, as long as you be careful that there's no leopard around. So this is eco-restoration. And this can happen. It is not so complicated, but you have to use good science to make it happen. Next, please. The next story is how do you use this for education? So even for our nature trail, we have a small nursery where we grow indigenous plants, right? And this is something so important. You have to learn a good bit of silviculture if you are going to do eco-restoration. It is not a plantation of eucalyptus, Acacia auriculoformis, Gericidia, and whatever your forest department's favorite species is at that time. And only if you are able to bring in those local species, indigenous species, next please, you will start immediately seeing a lot of things coming back that you may not even expect. For example, you got this Chloropsis here, which you have never seen so many for so many years in our nature trail, and now it's back. So these are the types of things that you can see. Next, please. The third study is my very old one. It starts with Tata Power, where we run school education programs. So we wanted a nature trail for them. And we started a 1.5 kilometer by 1 kilometer model area. We had an indigenous nursery of 40 species of trees. And we did all the things that I was telling you about. We brought in shrubs. We brought in Strobilanthus, which has been flowering every 7 years. This whole plantation area is 25 years old now, 30 years nearly. And we've got climbers, you've got Entada there, and we've got this small little wetland in there. So we have been able to recreate what we saw in our analysis of the best patches of forest in the Western Ghats close by to this area. And in 30 years, I remember taking Rajit Singh one late evening there and saying, "Sir, what do you think of the forest?" He said, "Yeah, beautiful forest." I said, "Sir, this is our plantation. This is our eco-restoration plot." So things come back and habitats really come back if you look at the biotic and the abiotic part of it. Look at what's happening in your detritus. What is happening with climbers? What is happening with even tree parasites and orchids and whatever. Next, please. The next thing is, here you see pictures from that nature trail. A jungle fowl, barking deer has come back. The other day, somebody said they saw a leopard, which I find difficult to believe. But this is what it looks like today. So it's taken us 30 years to get all this back there. Next, please. Right. And what we do is we use this for, that was the original purpose. This is why I was saying, what do you want? I wanted an area where I could take school kids and college kids and talk to them about ecology. And that's how we generated this. They also have a fantastic marsheer breeding area there, which we show them marsheer and actually make them catch the marsheer and release them back. So there could be many, many things that you can use an eco-restoration area for. Next, please. There is going to be this big new need now. Large number areas of semi-arid grasslands are going to be required for creating alternate energy from solar power plants, from wind generation plants. And we need to understand how we can match grassland ecology and grassland restoration with solar plants. And this is something that we have just started doing now. And many, many interesting findings. We can discuss it someday, sometime. Next, please. The last one is quite celebrated, actually. Some years ago, when there were youth games being planned in Pune, the then administrator for Pune, the commissioner, came and asked me, "Dr. Bharucha, what can we do to this dying wetland called Pashan?" And I said, "Yes, I know that is some place where I've been going for last 40 years taking pictures of birds, but it's gone now." So he said, "What do you think you can do there?" So I wrote a 2-page note, and I thought the municipal corporation wasn't going to anything, and I just left it. But they got funds at that time from JNNURN, the Jawaharlal Nehru mission. And they said, "Okay, let's do this. So you give me a more detailed thing." So what we did was, now these pictures that you are seeing are taken in the 1970s. So look at that village at the back. That was what the scenario was like. And what you are seeing down below is Pashan in 2019. with 700 cormorants. So this is it was very heavily silted. Now that siltation was very interesting. It is a 100-year-old British time dam, right? But all the silt that was there, some 70 to 80% of that silt was recent from a recently developed urbanization area around this lake. So what we did was we decided that we would remove this recently developed silt. And there was a lot of objection. They said, oh, then the water will drain out. But if you are careful with what you leave behind, water will continue to come back every monsoon. Okay. The other thing was there was a lot of invasive of water hyacinth, loss of typha. And these were all things that we identified that we would want later on. There was going to be urbanization. There was going to be water pollution. But there were some aspects like washing vehicles and clothes and things which we could stop. But there were certain things that were fait accompli. We could not do anything about that. There was an influx of water from this area which is being recently developed called Ramwadi, Ramnadi area. This was a small rivulet. It had degraded into a tiny little watercourse. Next, please. So we did many things, but this desilting only of the topsoil was a very important thing. And myself and the then administrator used to go there every fortnight on Sunday morning. And we would tell those fellows in the bulldozers, you can dig another couple of feet here, but this part you have to bring back. Around in the second year of all this activity, the commissioner again phoned me and he said, Doc, what am I to do with these tons and truckloads of silt? What am I to do with this? So I said, you are the commissioner, you decide where you want to dump the silt. But I told him, you take one side where there was possibility of widening of the road. And I said, you dump it there, we will plant it up with indigenous species. And whatever is left of that, we will make two islands inside. So the next quick, just go through them quickly, Anjali. You will see the change that is happening there. So this is pictures of early return of my some migrants, many local species. Then we started seeing the nesting of a couple of storks and ibis. And next, please. And then these are just a couple of images to show you what it looks like. That's Pashan Lake. And this was the early urbanization that had already started in 1970s. Next, please. This is what happened between 1973 and 2005. Next, please. And this is 2011. So you can see how rapidly urbanization is occurring. Now you can't wish this away. So wherever you plan an eco-restoration thing, you should be able to anticipate the other type of changes in land use which will occur. And if you can do that and you prevent, you can't prevent that urbanization probably, but you can prevent certain impacts of that. So along with this urbanization, the main thing to do was to prevent the wastewater coming back into Pashan Lake. And we did part of that. We built a weir and so on. And we had some good results from that. Next, please. A very quick review of this shows you the process by which it is happening. You can see the two islands developing there. The inflow at the bottom of the slide, we tried to create that into marshland, not very successful, I'm afraid. And you can see the early afforestation there and the roadway being expanded there. This is 2011. Next, please. This is also 2011, but in a different season. You can see how seasonal changes are very important to understand what is happening with seasonal changes. You can also see new urbanization coming out near the inflow. Next, please. Well, here, this is just 2 years down the line, right? And this is the time when, to our surprise, the birds started coming back. And a very important thing was that many of these birds, the storks, the ibis, the spoonbills, were using those two islands. And they were using some of the old trees that we left behind in the inflow part. Next, please. And that's where nesting colonies began to happen. So the whole scenario changed in about 5 years. right? And JNNURM said, when they did a review of all JNNURM projects, they thought this was one of the most unique projects that JNNURM had implemented. Next, please. But you must understand that this needs the cooperation. This needed the close cooperation of us along with the local administration, the Pune Municipal Corporation, that did a super job of this. So you can see here in May 2007, the inflow being made back, and we are trying to save those old trees that were already there. You can see the two islands being developed, and you can see here the Ipomia being removed, and the whole system by in 3 years sort of revamping itself, right? Next. And this is what I said, that we had anticipated this, but we didn't understand how rapidly this whole change to urbanization was going to occur. And not that we tried to do the best we can for the area. So you can see there's a traditional fisherman with his tube going back catching fish, which means there's fish there, but unfortunately most of them are tilapia, which the fisheries department released there. Next, please. And here you see what eco-restoration means. And as I told you earlier, for me, birds are the best indicator of what you have been able to achieve in a wetland like this. Next, please. So that's our institute where we planned this whole activity and which has come back. And these are the 4 or 5 eco-restoration projects that I have been involved with. And you know, when it really happens, it's extremely rewarding. Because when you see nature coming back like this, you know, you need to understand how good it is for you also. And that is when you bring good science into this restoration activity. So thank you very much for having me here. Bitapi, thank you so very much. I hope this has been a learning process. And I hope all of you will do a large number of great ecological projects where eco-restoration becomes the hallmark of bringing nature back. Thank you very, very much.